Hi everyone.
Hello.
Welcome to another Kitronik and Smoke and Mirrors live stream. My name is Emma.
And my name's Dominic.
And today we are going to be talking about polypropylene sheets.
So polypropylene, it's also shortened to PP, is a tough and rigid crystalline thermoplastic. Tough in block form at any rate. But in the sheet form that we're going to be talking about today, it's super lightweight and flexible.
Exactly.
It's made from a propylene monomer.
Mm.
So it's a thermoplastic.
Yeah, that's cool.
So it has a lot of uses. I mean, it's such a versatile material. It's used in automotive industry.
Mm.
But it's used hugely in packaging and point of sale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've definitely seen a few point of sales in like cosmetic stores and stuff.
One of the advantages of it is it's very easy to print on.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So, you know, if you wanted to have a display sign that was super flexible but very light, you print on it with the right kind of printer and up it goes.
Yeah.
Hang it from the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
Bend it around the thing.
Yeah, lightweight so it won't pull any hooks down.
Shelf edge label.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, without further ado, I mean, obviously, I want to talk about laser cutting, but this material, unlike many of the others,
mm-hmm.
Is way more versatile than that. You can not just laser cut it; you can pretty much tear it with your fingers. Although I struggle to tear this; it's quite strong.
Yeah.
I had a piece out front earlier, and I was just tearing it. I can't do it now.
Hulk mode.
Yeah, so not a very clean way of working with it.
No.
But we are going to show some really precise ways of working with mm-hmm. it.
Yep. So we do sell it at Kitronik.
What a surprise.
Yeah. What a surprise. We have three different thicknesses. It depends on the kind of polypropylene as to what thickness is available. Is available in 0.5, 0.8, and 0.73. That's a little bit more precise, that one. 0.73 is only in frosted. This is some lovely blue transparent polypropylene, which I find work very well for light diffusion.
Just about to see my hand through that. Though.
Yeah.
I haven't got a light to shine through it from this side.
No.
All the lights are on the other side. But
you can see the shadow.
You can see, yeah.
Yeah.
See my hand.
You can see, yeah, that's all right then. The bigger sheets we do are 1050 by 750 millimetres.
So that's like a metre long.
Yeah.
By what, about that wide.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, so big old sheets.
Yeah. Good for laser cutters.
Good for big laser cutters.
Good for big laser cutters, yeah. You'd have to cut it down for a smaller one.
Well, we're going
to
do that, aren't
we? Oh, we sure are. So, we also have some opaque sheets in 1100 by 650, which is a little bit narrower and longer. So it depends on the
opaque sheet. It has been used. But hold that up. So you can't see my hand for it.
Yeah. So that would be better for, you know, depending on the format of your laser cutter. And the smallest one we do is 500 by 350 millimetres, that is.
So. And that one, that's opaque sheets, isn't it, as well? So,
yeah.
And this is the frosted.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This is one of the frosted. We do this in two thicknesses, I think.
Yes.
0.5 and 0.75.
Yeah.
Of 1 millimetre. So as you can see, like, totally flexible.
Mm-hmm.
As you might expect from sheeted plastic.
Yeah. And it's lovely and frosted there as well, so it's good for light diffusion, like I said before.
We should talk about polypropylene sheets moment in recent history. With Kitronik's face shield design. We don't have one of the face shields handy. We did have one in the back, but it was made from
PETG
sheet as an example of using that material.
Yeah.
But we're not talking about PETG today, we're talking about polypropylene. The face shield headbands that lots and lots of our customers made in schools mm-hmm. during the early pandemic when a PPE was hard to come by
mm-hmm.
was made from this material. Both thicknesses we use. In fact, the whole point was we had lots and lots of this material, but it was very difficult to get hold of any PETG at the time.
Yeah.
Because PETG was snapped up for making sneeze guards and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
And so one of the designers at Kitronik came up with a headband that you could attach an acetate. I think it was an acetate. I forget the chemical sheet that was used, but an existing acetate sheet. And so lots of laser cutters that I go and visit in schools still have a white residuey dust from laser cutting polypropylene and little off cuts from making huge numbers of those face shields.
Mm-hmm.
I think here at Kitronik they made several thousand in that first lockdown mm-hmm. period. But I was just remembering one of the serious uses for the sheet that we had here.
Mm-hmm.
But I was going to talk about finishes.
Oh, yeah.
So our sheets have two styles of finish. It's going to be super difficult to see them on the camera, but we'll do our best. The side I'm holding up to the light here, and I'm bending in the light, this is described as fine sand finish. Mm-hmm. In other words, this has the texture of fine sand or fine sanding, I suppose you could describe it. But that's how it's called, fine sand. And it's very smooth looking, slightly textured finish.
Mm-hmm.
On the other side, and I only learned this term today, I have to admit it, but I quite like it. It's called orange emboss. And I was like, well, it's not orange.
Mm.
It's frosted. But it's like the skin of an orange.
Yeah.
At least that's what I assume it comes from. So it has a sort of, it's like anti-glare. It's to prevent, you know, strong light flashing back. So if you can kind of see from the lights we've got here in the live stream studio, there's a bit more light kickback from that side than from that side. It's negligible, but you get the idea.
Yeah.
And that's the same on all our sheets,
mm-hmm.
With the exception of some that have sand finish on both sides.
Yes. Yeah.
And obviously, if you go to the page and click down through the information, mm-hmm. you should be able to determine which has which.
Exactly. Yeah. If in fact, would you like to do that now? We can.
Yes, let's have a look at the stuff that we have for sale at Kitronik.
Right, which side will this catch on?
So obviously this is all available in the materials section at Kitronik. So that's kitronik.co.uk/materials.
Mm-hmm. So here's our polypropylene section. You can reach this section just by going to the materials dropdown, clicking on polypropylene. You can have a look here in under these tabs. But if you just click on polypropylene, it'll bring you here and you'll be able to see everything that we have. So...
I just want to scroll, Emma, if you would scroll up to the top of this page,
mm-hmm.
and so we have the graphic here with the create flexible designs using polypropylene and a very nice curvy graphic of the polypropylene, which just, you know, is an illustration of how you might end up having it
mm-hmm.
at your workspace, at your classroom or wherever.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, if you are going to laser cut it, it's best to lay it flat.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Whilst it lends itself very well to being rolled up like a poster.
Mm.
Or just shoved in the back of a cupboard.
Yeah.
When it comes to laser cutting, laying it flat and leaving it flat with, you know, some other materials on top to keep it flat is going to help laying it out on a laser cutter bed.
Mm-hmm.
But as we're going to discuss, you know, we're not only going to be laser cutting it, you know, you could roll it up if you wanted to.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just for the advantages of laser cutting, don't.
Yeah. So if I go here to... So this is our transparent polypropylene. As you can see, we've got four different colours. If you just scroll down here, it should give us... some information. So we have pin seal finish on one side.
Pin seal?
Yeah, this one says pin seal rather than orange...
Orange emboss.
Orange emboss. But with the same thing.
These terms might be like the... I think we have a couple of suppliers for polypropylene, so these things may be specific to the supplier, of course.
Mm-hmm. And some examples. They will always have examples as well, our materials, of what a material is often used for. So this could be useful for you if you're workshopping ideas, especially if it's a D&T classroom.
I mean, a material as flexible as polypropylene in sheet form like this is great for mocking up quick.
Oh, yeah.
Prototypes of especially like packaging or, you know, electronics enclosures. I've seen this used mm-hmm. very effectively as an electronics enclosure with a flat flat pack folded design. So creased with the laser cutter using a non-full power linear movement, you know, mm-hmm. so not cutting through the material, but leaving a mark in it.
Yeah.
And then with the edges cut out, so the whole thing like a can be folded somewhat like a McDonald's box.
Yeah.
And then clipped together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That sounds interesting. Maybe I'll have a go at that. Here's another Finnish piece of information. Static treated to minimize dust attraction, that's good. Because as Dominic said earlier, these do create a fair amount of dust when you're laser cutting. Just make sure your extraction's good.
Well, that dust is the polypropylene being obliterated, if you like, by the laser beam. Yeah. And obviously not combusting, but like if the material's being removed by the laser beam, it has to go somewhere. And where it goes is into a white dust. And could we bring that video up that we shot earlier?
Absolutely we can. Let's... There you go. So here's a good video that Dominic shot of cutting some polyprop.
So this is the sort of marking I'm talking about. So this is the laser working in a cut operation, or you know, a line operation if you're using light burn, but with the power and the speed such that it's not going all the way through the material and it's just leaving, you know, a marking in there. And in this case, obviously, it's for lettering. But you could equally use that for marking in creases mm-hmm. for something that you need to fold. And even I would say the lightest scoring of one surface would allow for the material to be bent back. And we were doing the same kind of scoring with a Stanley blade.
Yeah, yeah.
Earlier, which we'll show in close up in a moment. And now here we go, here's the cut, and you see it works quite nicely as an illustration on this video where the debris from the cut, in other words, the parts of the material that are being vaporized are being pushed into the knife bed below the laser cutter here, and you can see that white smoke, and that white smoke is essentially the vaporized polypropylene
mm-hmm.
and then when that white smoke settles, it leaves a white residue of polypropylene dust, PP mm-hmm. dust, and you could just, you know, wipe that up with a rag, but if you are working with polypropylene a lot, you know, as machines were during the pandemic,
yeah,
you know, you're going to get a lot of this whiting. It's fairly heavy, so it drops down. It tends to be on the working bed of the machine.
Yeah.
Doesn't tend to become airborne and settle on all parts of the machine. So that's a benefit at least.
Yeah. Yeah, it's easier to clean that way.
Yeah, not an advertised benefit though.
No.
There you go. You can see some of the vaporized polypropylene there is just causing a little bit of sort of flashing back along the as the laser beam travels across the metal parts of the laser cutter. I'm quite proud of this video. I think it looks awesome.
Yeah, I like how the smoke is staying between the knife blades there. That's it's very aesthetically pleasing
and illustrative of how the laser cutter is pulling the extract gases out to the mm-hmm. to the extraction fan. And I should find that item that we cut so I can hold it up.
Absolutely. There we go. We've looped back to the beginning. So if we just go to a face camera.
No, we're back on screen. So, you can actually see in this design, well, it's not easy for you to see at home, I don't think, but there's little white bumps there where some reflected energy from the laser cutter has gone back onto the polyprop. And obviously, you know, that is one of the aspects of working with a laser cutter and polypropylene. You are working with a laser beam that effectively is unable to stop suddenly. Mm-hmm. It has to keep going somewhere and then it reflects back. But obviously this is a large letter, what do you call it? Like a guide. So if you're posting things out, you could cut something like this and use it to check that your package meets the requirements for large letter.
That's very cool.
But yeah, it's quite a useful thing if you are sending a lot of large letters, I suppose, which I do. But yeah, there you go. I might take that away with me afterwards. But also on the material, you can just see, you know, it needs a bit of a wipe down. And I wonder, can we bring this camera up?
Absolutely.
You can look at this lettering.
There you go.
Well, it's a little hard to focus, but you can just about see the lettering on there. Is there a way to make that a bit tighter? Do I need
if
to?
If you bring it up towards the camera, it's
there we go.
There you are.
And then I'll just focus it in. Yeah. I mean, it's a whole month since I've used this camera, so let's turn it around so it makes sense. There you go. You see, that's not a terrible effect.
It does leave that little bit of a ridge on there, but I like that.
It's essentially, and you know, yeah, maybe not as clean as doing the same thing onto something like a piece of MDF or a piece of ply, because the plastic becomes heated and melts. In fact, let's grab the example of the engravings right here. So as a second experiment, we ran the laser cutter in the engraving mode, or the scan mode, or the fill mode, it has various names, as you might do to engrave it. And there's such a buildup of heat that the plastic, actually, the polypropylene sheet started to bend up and out of the way of the laser beam. And that's why it sort of stopped. So you can see these sections here, just about, you can see them anyway, where there's some engraving and then it's kind of lost. And so a way of preventing that might be to hold the sheet down with magnets. But ultimately, what I'm saying is, it's not really suitable for engraving.
No, yeah, it's far too. It is a thermoplastic, like you said earlier. So it will
react, move, change.
Yeah, you get hot and move. That's the description.
So I mean, you can heat it with a heat gun.
Yeah.
Emma, you've more experience than that, haven't you?
So I have actually got. I've got some examples. Let me excuse me dropping myself off camera there for a second. So this is a small test I did about 5 minutes before we went on stream to demonstrate the difference between bending polypropylene when it's cold and when it is heated. This I did with a heat gun, and first of all, the difference you can really see is that there is a line there, stress.
It's like white coloured, isn't it? In this black, this is a thick black polyprop.
So I'm sure it's one of those things you might have seen before on, like, if you've got something that's made out of polypropylene or...
Oh, and you get the thing where you keep bending it.
Yeah, bending backwards and forwards. I used to do that in class all the time as a kid. And, you know, this is just like a stress, basically. But if you use a heat gun to bend, you don't get the same... You don't get the same effect. In fact, the heat gun almost heat polishes the front, so it's a little bit shinier.
Yes. It's not a heat polish, strictly speaking, as it's melting the surface.
Yeah.
And so I suppose you're losing some of the that sand finish or that pin finish, pin fine finish that they were talking about, or obviously on this piece, that's the sand finish and that's the orange emboss.
Yeah. And The other difference I noticed between these, you might notice how this isn't as bent as this. This doesn't seem to have the same structural integrity. This is quite firmly, it's a thermoplastic. It is where you want to know.
You're right, yeah.
Where you want it to go. And then this, on this side, it's like folding paper. And the more you do it, the thinner it'll get and it'll just snap off.
Eventually. I mean, it's, I suppose, as a rapid prototyping technique, you know, I've almost got a right and I've got that. It's not terrible.
Yeah.
But I would like to show, working it with a Stanley blade. So let's bring the close-up camera. Oh, okay.
Just
sorry.
You do that.
Yes.
Here's something I made earlier. so if you heat up the polypropylene a little bit too much, it might deform like this. Now, this was intentional when I first joined Kitronik. Mm. So it's been a couple of years since I did this.
Is it a lamp?
Yes, it is. It's croc clip leads. So I don't have anything to turn it on with. But you can see here a hole has appeared. And the top has sort of curled over.
What did you do to make it like this?
Heat gun. If you keep heating, it becomes so malleable that it's almost hard to control because you really can't hold it when it's that hot. So yes, be careful. Don't try this at home.
You've melted it into a hot plastic. It's hot enough to melt.
Yeah.
And therefore, it's hot enough to burn your fingers.
Exactly.
So if you are using this technique, you know, try to make sure that you're not handling that plastic directly with your skin.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to demonstrate cutting this material now with a blade. So if we could switch to the desktop camera. There we go. Completely out of focus. I'm sure you'll adjust it.
I shall.
There we go.
So
not that I want to teach people such basic techniques, but I'm going to. Always let the blade do the work. Don't try and drag through a material in one pass. Just keep going, scoring along until the job is done. Mm-hmm. Makes for a much cleaner, safer cut. And as you can see, you know, that's a very, very clean cut through the material. Slight burr where the knife has applied pressure to the edge, and you get a similar burr laser cutting from meltback.
Yeah.
Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to score at an angle here, just once. And I can see the line. And obviously, if I bend it away from where I've cut, you can see the stress mark in the plastic on the inside, if you like, of the cut. So it's going to be slightly less strong along this seam, but as you can see, you know, you get a very clean finish. So you don't have to have a laser cutter to work with this stuff.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, you should get a laser cutter. But you have to have a laser cutter.
Laser cutters are good.
And then,
yes,
even simpler. Scissors. We can
easy
make sure, you know, so if you are buying sheets larger than your cutter, if you are using it for the laser cutter at school or for your project or for your prototyping, obviously you can cut your sheets to size.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you want a rapid prototype right there on a desk, all you need is a pair of scissors.
Exactly.
Little harder to make a hole, I suppose, but you know, one method might be to put an X to allow you to push. I was trying to think of their name this morning, and there used to be something when I was a lad was everywhere. They're like a brass pin with a split pin that you can pull the legs apart and they hold these together.
Yeah,
I'm sure they have a proper name. I can't think what it is off the top of my head.
Split pin is accurate.
I think they've got a proper name.
Oh yeah.
But I don't know what it is. And no. What am I going to Google? Split pins from my childhood.
Yeah. Tack with legs.
I even feel like I thought I bought a pack of them for projects and I was looking for them. But yeah. So good story that.
Mm,
Stencils.
Yeah.
Shall we grab a stencil and then I'm going to go get it. You can bring it back up.
That sounds good. Let me go back to the... would you like to show the video or the stencil first?
I would like to show the stencil.
Ah, perfect. There's the camera.
So I took the liberty of borrowing the font from the well-known stencil artist Banksy. But if we had some contact adhesive or even Pritt stick, we were going to use Pritt stick, weren't we?
Yeah.
You could stick this up here, spray can, psh, done.
Yeah.
Gone, easy. Running into the night.
yeah.
You know, not that I want to encourage, I want to encourage street art, but not...
not the illegal sort.
Not the illegal sort. Well... but for stencils, it's pretty good. the thinner the material, probably the better.
Yeah.
But it does the job very nicely. I think you get the idea from that.
Exactly.
I think if I'd have bought something different to write, I might have sprayed that up there. Maybe thanks.
Yeah. Yeah.
But great for stencils. Mm-hmm. Probably not ideal for cake topping type stencils. It's a bit too thick.
Yeah.
Mylar sheets would be better for that. But certainly does the job.
Yeah, exactly.
Another usage that I've seen polypropylene for recently, and I was going to try and design my own, but I didn't in the end. I just found them at a bicycle shop, is mudguards for bicycles.
Super
lightweight, very easy to attach to the bike with some cable ties, keeps mud and rain off, you know, because it can be so easily shaped. And I think these were die cut. I've got them at, you know, a well-known cycle shop. And they had scored lines on that I think had been pressed with a hydraulic press. Okay. So where it needed to be folded, it was hydraulic pressed into the polypropylene sheet. And then obviously it had been die cut into the right shape and printed with instructions on it as well.
That's
so
very cool.
You know, and they probably cost the company pennies to make.
Yeah,
and they were selling them for pounds. And worth every pound because it did the job perfectly. It saved me time having to design my own. But I could have prototyped one up with a pair of scissors, you know, and a bit of sheet. I mean, what?
Absolutely.
Our cheapest sheet, black like this, in 0.5 millimetre thick, £1.50 at the moment under current prices, plus delivery, of course. But, you know, really, you could have a sheet for prototyping and then a sheet for doing. And with the right sort of equipment, you could scan the sheet. Mm-hmm. You could then capture the bitmap in your CAD software. And it wouldn't even have to draw it up. You could use the prototype that you've cut right there live in the room.
Yeah, yeah. Easy enough.
Do you want to tell me about tabs and slots?
You know what? I think it's what I made earlier.
So this is
an awfully 70s lampshade I made. There's a little hole up here made for, you know, like a hanging lamp.
Have you seen the super elaborate ones that are pieces of, it is polypropylene, I believe, and they all tessellate together and slot fit together?
Yes, I love those. This one is extremely simple. So if I just pull it out, you'll see there is a slot.
Oh, wow, I didn't know. Okay, of course it comes apart, but it comes apart easily.
Very easily. So there is a slot right there and then a tab which serves a dual purpose of attaching the this piece into a circle. So it's simply just that shape and a cylinder in the middle.
And you've got these tabs and slots on your cylinder.
So let me, would you like to demonstration camera?
There's an awful mess down there at the moment. Let me tidy
that up. Oh no, I've caught you.
Carried away cutting the polypropylene off camera.
Caught you in 4K.
Okay, so yes, I can lay this out here and you can see the shape that Emma's created in her design.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what do you call that? That's the tab.
The tab.
And then on the other side, I mean, this is not rocket science stuff, but it's very effective. And the tolerances on this lamp that you've made are, I would say, you know, you've not gone in there with precision and you've knocked this up as a fun project.
Yeah.
But even so, that is held really strongly with that wider tab there.
Yeah. And the benefit of polypropylene for something like this is that it is flexible. So you'd never be able to do this with an acrylic.
No, it'd shatter.
Yeah, yeah.
But you'd have to have the measurements absolutely spot on.
Yeah.
Whereas I can bend this little with my fingers and just pop it out.
Like
and even put it the wrong way around.
Exactly.
He says. even doing that, I can see now that I'm starting to make a mess of it. But hey, if there's no tension in the show, who's going to watch the show, you know?
This is this conflict and resolution.
Conflict and resolution.
Yeah.
You all thought that wasn't going to go back together for a minute, didn't you?
God, yeah. It was tense. Tense.
Okay. I want to show now an item that colleague, a friend of mine, mm-hmm. has made.
Oh, yeah.
Let's grab.
This is very good. How cool is this?
So, this... Oh, I'm not even holding it up.
No, you're not.
So, this is a working... Well, I say working as in it folds down and then unfills. It's a wing. Obviously, it's a wing. And it's made by Laura Matthews. Laura Matthews, artist. You can look her up on Instagram, TikTok, and her website, lauramatthewsart.co.uk, I believe it is. Maybe you could search that, Emma. Oh, you know, we can make sure we get that correctly.
I think she's in our... in our chat as well.
Yes, Laura, you're in our chat. Maybe you could put your links in the chat for people that are interested. But I know that, like, Laura was experimenting with, I think she'd used paper and other... it's lauramatthewsart.com.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And use other... materials, but polypropylene obviously allows that level of flexibility, but lightweightness. And you can see all of these wing, each of these wing pieces, I think every one of them is individually designed to a specific shape. So even these ones here, and I don't know enough about wings to tell you what those feathers would be called, but each one is very slightly... And these three might be the same, but the very slight difference is this ridge here, where there's a slight curve, where the, for want of a better word, the bone, or the, would it be a bone under a wing? Or the part of the wing that has the...
Yeah, the shaft of the feather.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, is created by a crease in the wing, and then it's all sewn together with thread. And you should go check her work out. Because whilst this wing is incredibly complicated, you know, there are all kinds of anatomical animals, and I think she's been working on a phoenix, and there's mammals, there's all kinds of stuff. There's,
and
I think there's one where kangaroos attack like a triceratops in one of her videos. It's very good stuff.
Very anyway, good.
Yeah, that's cool. And I'm going to put that back carefully because I don't want to damage it. And then what can I bring, like, your other lamp?
Yeah, that sounds good. That sounds good. It's just demonstrating how the polypropylene can be used for light diffusion and also as a colour filter for light. So, in fact, what might be fun is if I just take it apart a bit.
While you're doing that, I've got a newsflash.
Oh, go on then.
Mark, who's about my age... says they're called paper fasteners. Those brass pin leg things.
Paper fasteners?
Yeah, I mean, you know.
Huh.
I could have guessed that, I think. It's pretty obvious name for them. I don't think we sell them at Kitronik, but you can find them in stationery shops.
Mm. So you can see here the tubes. So there is a lighting module at the bottom there. And in order to diffuse the light and to create star patterns on the walls, I've used two layers of polypropylene. The inside one is transparent and blue to colour the light because it is a white LED module. And then the stars on the outside are in black, opaque polypropylene. So it only comes through the star-shaped pinholes.
Oh, so the light is diffused by the transparent sheet, and then the opaque sheet's too thick for the light to come through, so you get your star shapes.
Exactly.
Yeah, we it's not possible really under the lights for us to demonstrate it. It's you know, it's sort of a nightlight type thing.
Exactly. Yeah. 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 But it's, yeah, you can see here all it takes for me to attach it into a circle really is I've made these two enclosures at the bottom and the top, and there is a tiny ridge where it sits, and so that just pops on the top, and the ridge encapsulates the polypropylene. So it's again extremely easy to work with.
Well, I think, you know, we're coming towards the end, so we probably want to list our pros and cons.
Oh, good.
And usually we make a list of them, don't we? But in this case, we were sort of struggling to think of cons.
Yeah.
And most of the cons would be related to usage, as in you couldn't use it for a structural thing.
Yeah.
Which, you know, is hardly a con. The material is suitable for doing what the material will do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's what, as laserables go, for example, mm-hmm. you know, it's so versatile with the ability to be able to crease it and cut it and shape it. Mm-hmm. And to be able to take it, say, onto a table and wrap a prototype with it before you do any laser cutting,
mm-hmm.
you know, you can go from prototype to product almost literally in minutes.
Yeah.
So if you've not used it in school or you've not used it at home, it's worth a go. It's lightweight.
Yeah.
It's actually a colleague of mine, Nicolette, lives in Central Europe in Luxembourg, found it very, very hard to buy polypropylene sheet on the European continent.
Nice.
Whereas, you know, we've got it here at Kitronik for people in the UK, no problem whatsoever. I know you said no problemo, but I feel that would have been inappropriate talking about. Let's move on from that. So, super useful material,
mm-hmm.
rapid prototyping.
Yep.
Package design,
mm-hmm.
you print on it,
yep.
laser cut it,
mm-hmm.
you can scissors cut it,
mm-hmm.
you can blade cut it,
mm-hmm.
you can hand fold it,
mm-hmm.
chemical resistant,
yep.
anti-static,
yep. Light diffusion. Yeah, that's my favourite one.
It's a versatile material.
Yeah. And easy to join, with tabs and slots especially.
Yes.
And
as you saw with the wing made by Laura, you know, mm-hmm. You could push a needle through it, but obviously if you were using it with Fred, I would think, and I don't do much of this, but I think you do a bit of this, don't you? Sort of props and costume design.
Yeah.
Super useful for that.
Yeah.
I
would either, to get a sewing needle through, I would either use an awl,
which yes. is
just a punch tool. I would literally use a hole punch on it because some of those are probably not the weaker ones made for thinner paper, but some of those might work. Eyelet tools, or even perhaps have the laser cutter do the work for you.
Yes, if you're laser cutting.
Yeah.
One last thing about the pandemic time, the face shields. Advantages. When we were talking with people at the NHS about this design, the design that was used for the face shields, the standard face guard at the time in the NHS, and you often see these now, contained a piece of foam, latex, I think it's latex foam, you know, soft foam to sit on the head, and they couldn't really, they were saying that there was essentially one use and goes in the bin. There wasn't effective way. There may have been an effective way later on, but there wasn't a perceived effective way to clean it, whereas they were able to autoclave these,
mm-hmm.
and to even just, you know, spray and wipe,
mm-hmm.
Because they are so versatile. So highly versatile plastic, great for your laser,
mm-hmm.
why not try it today?
Exactly,
that's what we're saying.
Yeah, that's the long and short of it.
What we're going to do next time?
Ooh,
I would like to do stamp rubber.
You know what? That sounds great.
So yeah. Maybe tune in. We're going to try and bring an episode to you at the end of September,
mm-hmm.
last Thursday of the month.
Yep.
And we think we're going to do stamp rubber.
Yep.
So making a stamp, maybe we'll show that from scratch.
Oh, that would be lovely.
Well, we're going to decide now, aren't we?
Yeah, we will.
Right, say goodbye, Emma.
Oh, all right. Goodbye, Emma. All right. See you later, everyone. Have a good rest of your day. We will see you at the end of September for potentially stamp rubber. Check out our socials. They're all at the bottom here.
Yours are over there.
Yep. And yours are...
right there.
We're mirrored. Follow us for updates on when the next one's going to be, new products, all of that business. And we'll see you next time.